Hello and welcome to Deprogram with Carrie Smith. I'm your host, Carrie. If you're watching this live or for the premiere when it comes out, you are watching on Thursday at 6 o'clock Central. That's when the Deprogrammed interviews come out. I'm very excited about my guest today. She is hilarious. She goes by Daywalker Comedy. You may have seen her videos on Twitter, on YouTube. She is a comedian writer. She describes herself as politically homeless, which, funny enough, so do I, and bleeding heart edge lady, which I want to ask about. What does that mean? Who went from being a D-list actress to being a D-list actress who makes quasi-problematic sketch comedy on the internet? Please welcome Daywalker Comedy.
Hey.
Hey. Thank you for joining me today.
I'm really excited to be here. You're somebody that I've been wanting to share war stories with for a while.
Oh, but then let's get into it. I'm sure you have. We have a lot of a similar kind of story, because I used to work in comedy in my old life, behind the scenes in comedy. But first of all, I want to thank our friend Epic Mike, because he's the one that brought you to my attention, and he was like, "You're gonna love this girl. She's so funny." And I can't tell you how many times your videos actually make me do the literal lol, LOL,
really?
Laugh out loud. Yes. They're so funny.
So you never know when you make stuff if it's going to be funny to anybody but you. But like, that's kind of my rubric is like, well, if I chuckle while editing it, hopefully somebody else will.
Yes. We just did our first sketch here on the Deprogram channel a month and a half ago. And I had no idea if it was going to be funny or not, but I had a lot of fun making it. I was like, so at least I laughed.
I want to see it. That's cool. Like, yeah. I want more people to be making stuff. I think that's so cool that people are like in the space or, you know, finally creating art.
Yes. Yes. More room for laughter. So why don't you tell people, just who may not be familiar with you, tell people a little bit about yourself and what you're doing with Daywalker Comedy.
So I am, and I'll say my name here. My name's Amanda Miller. I'm an actor. I lived in LA for like 8 years. I do a lot of voiceover. I do some on camera, theater, all that. And I kind of was looking for a creative outlet because I've always been in love with comedy. I always loved, back in the day, I loved SNL. I always wanted to be on it. I loved Mad TV. I loved all my like sketch comedy stuff, Kids in the Hall, you know, Chappelle Show, all that. And I was noticing that comedy wasn't making me laugh like it used to. And I was like, man, like, I just want to, like, I wish I would see the stuff that I grew up laughing at, like, or like the Boondocks or whatever, where it was stuff that either made fun of everybody. Like, it just found whatever was funny, regardless of allegiances, and just said what needed to be said. And so I just kind of started making it. It took me about a year to build up my courage to do it because I'm in Hollywood. And as you know, I'm sure, because you were in LA, right?
Well, yeah. And that's why I didn't say your name at the beginning, because I wasn't sure, because
it's more the social media thing I worry about.
But yeah. Here it's fine. Yeah. So you had to get over fear of just putting out problematic, funny stuff.
Yeah. Well, it's weird because like I have friends on both sides and they're all like, this isn't as like, I don't know, shocking as you think it is. Like in my head, in my circles, I'm used to people who are extremely like, I don't know, I feel like now it's not cool to say like woke anymore, but whatever the word is, like very like, you can't say that, you know, the scolds, like you can't do anything. That's the world that I live in. Like actors tend to be very whatever, like avant-garde, like whatever the most crazy new term is, they're the ones who are using it the most. Like whatever PGM is now. I thought we were BIPOC, then we were POC. I don't know what I am anymore. I'm just vaguely brown now.
Wait a minute, there's a new one?
PGM? Yeah, I think PGM is like, somebody says like persons of a global majority. There's that, and then there's ADOS, which is like a not adult descendants, African descendants of slaves, because like not like black doesn't cover it. You have to be like, well, no, we suffered more than you. Like you're black but you're Nigerian, or you're black but you're British. So we have like specific terms for that now.
Wow, you've heard it here first, guys, right along with me. New terms out, breaking. Yep. Breaking.
If you say BIPOC now you're a bigot. That's outdated. That's like saying colored or something.
I was in that woke world back then. We called it social justice for 20 years and while working in entertainment. And you were right. There are always new terms being coined. Now that I'm out of it, looking, but when you're in it, when I was in it, I couldn't see all this. But once you get out, the longer you're out, the more you can see it clearly. And I think now so much of that has to do with control, because if it's constantly evolving, the taboo list of things you can't say or the new phrases you have to say, then people live with this sort of fear, this self-censor in their head of, I've got to be up to date on what the PC thing is, and I can't make a misstep because my own people, my
Will
own
turn on you.
will turn on me.
Yeah, it's like a purity test, and I don't know why. Like, it's very kind of abusive to me. Like, and I feel a lot calmer now that I'm not in that world anymore. But when I was there, I was always like, I'm trying to just say like even a nice thing, but you're like, if you use the wrong terms, if you use it the wrong way, like everything's like, ah, and you're constantly explaining what you didn't mean. You're like, and I'm not saying this, or I apologize if that comes across insensitive. Like, you can't just say a basic thing like without. This crazy anxiety, and like it, like I felt like I don't know, tension in my throat all the time because I'm like, am I supposed to say that? Don't say that. Oh, you're gonna get in trouble. And it felt like always this punitive aspect around you, like everybody likes you unless you make a misstep, and that's not friendship to me.
That's not, it's basically Stasi, like keeping each other in check. Your own friends and family could report you, kind of thing. You're making me think of, when you said you felt this tension in your throat, I have a friend that I know from when I worked in entertainment. We're much better friends now. It's funny, once I had my coming out, period, and the great unfriending, I call it. The great unfriending happened, but then I became closer with some people who had just been acquaintances before because they felt like, oh, it's safe to reach out to her. And so anyway, one of my very good friends, she works in entertainment to this day. And she had a psychosomatic thing that was happening where she was actually losing her voice. And she thinks it was related to keeping quiet about her opinions. And once she started sharing a little more of herself with people, that went away. Like, isn't that crazy?
I believe it. I very much believe that. And sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. I just agree very much. Like we're humans. We're not just like our minds. We're not just our feelings. We're our bodies. We're like all of it's interconnected. And especially as like artists and creatives, like you, if you aren't speaking your truth, you're kind of just stagnating. I mean, it's cheesy to bring up theater, but I'm a theater person. But was it Langston Hughes where it's like a dream deferred? We're talking. He talks about like when you don't let it live, you don't let your dreams like happen. They just like was it they I should remember the whole thing, but they basically like ra they shrivel up like a raisin in the sun is the essence of that. And you just I feel so sad for a lot of my actor friends or creatives who some of them behind the scenes I know feel similarly to me, but they're like I can't like I just I and they just live these repressed double
Muted.
lives. Yeah.
Like on mute. That's how.
Yeah. Yeah, like the volume turned really, really low down. Like they're giving some of themselves, they're giving like maybe a little bit of their personality, but they're not giving their real thoughts, which to me, art should be, I mean, not just our thoughts, but it should be our unique perspective on the world. And I feel like you're not getting real art if you're trying to obey, you know, like you're trying to obey the censors, you're trying to obey, like, oh, I have to have this many people who look like this or fit these boxes or whatever in my project, as opposed to just, is it a good story? Is it a human story? Is it moving people? You
Yes.
know?
It's I think that happens necessarily with ideology. If your ideology is so puritanical, maybe, or fundamentalist, that it becomes the priority in everything, even more important than in your art or, the purpose of your company or whatever. It's more important than the laughter.
Yeah.
I'll share another quick anecdote with you. When I first started leaving the social justice cult, another acquaintance who we did not become very close after this. I think I was unfriended by her probably. I had shared something about a SNL sketch. You mentioned you missed back when SNL was very funny, and I'd shared this kind of this woke sketch. It was a You may remember it. It was like all the women in the cast, and it was something about it was a song. Supposed to be a funny song about rape.
Oh.
And it wasn't funny. It was just basically lecturing. It was terrible. And how, scary it is to be a woman, kind of thing. And I remember sharing it and saying, this isn't funny. And I said exactly that, like the ideology is more important than the laughter here. And this former friend of mine, who's very still in that world, that woke world, said, I agree it's not funny, but the message is very important. And so that's why we have to do stuff like this, because we got to get the message out there. I'm like, you just proved my point. It's a comedy show. It's
That's
supposed to be.
funny. Important is such a word that, like, I've noticed people say when something isn't good. They're like, wow, that was so important. Like, it might, if it's preachy, if it's whatever, like, if it's good, you'll say, that was so good. But I see people say, this is so important. This message is so needed right now, which lets you know, like, it was garbage.
It's garbage. Can I start off by showing a clip of
Yeah.
your comedy? Okay. You don't mind watching yourself? Let's put it this
No, I'm
way.
curious which ones you've picked.
Okay. I've got a couple. I want to start with this, and we'll put at the bottom, actually in the description of the video, you can find links to Daywalker comedy, so you can go and watch the full videos, and there's so much stuff there to check out that'll make you laugh. So let's see. I'm going to start with SJW's Anonymous.
Okay.
Just the beginning. It's so funny. Just your wigs in this alone.
I have so many wigs. I have like an assortment over here,
Yes.
a rack of them.
I have a box. When friends stay, they're like, you have a box of wigs? Of course. I
Like,
need them.
who doesn't have a dress-up box? Come on now.
Okay, guys. SJW's Anonymous from Daywalker Comedy.
Welcome to the regular meeting of Social Justice Warriors Anonymous. My name is Bex, and I'm an activist. Hi,
Hi, Bex.
Bex. Let's start with a recitation of the 12 steps. We admitted we were powerless over the shame and insecurities of our own lives, and therefore decided to make everyone else's lives unmanageable too. Came to believe weaponizing that shame and judgment to control others' actions, speech, and every possible situation ever could return us to sanity. Made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of grifters trying to sell us hot takes, clickbait, and expensive diversity training seminars. Took a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves and found that it was pointless because no matter how hard we try, we will never be pure enough. Admitted to Ibram X. Kendi, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our racism. Humbly asked him to remove our shortcomings, and if that didn't work, Robin DiAngelo's cleansing would be fine too, I guess.
Okay, I'm stopping there. You guys, I'm just stopping there. I'm not showing the whole thing because I want you to go watch the whole thing at Daywalker Comedy. The link's below. It's so good.
It's that was one of the first ones I put out, and I feel like it might have been one of my spicier ones just because it was very personal. Like every like later, when if people go watch it, some of the sins that some of them are confessing are things that I've actually gotten in trouble for. So it's just like it was very like, and this kind of goes back to what you were saying about the SNL sketches about like, they were trying to make a sketch about rape and whatever, and it's like, I personally think you can almost make a sketch about anything, but it's how you do it and it's what you're making fun of. Are you making fun of a person? Are you making fun of the action? Or are you making fun of the way we think about the action? Like, you can kind of find a way to make fun of anything, but SNL, I find, and a lot of people nowadays are making things so on the nose where they're like, we can't joke about this. Like the what was it? The abortion one where it was like the clown. Do you remember that one? It was like a Weekend Update.
Oh, yes.
And I
Yeah.
feel like there
They
was a way
didn't.
that they could have made it funny, but
They didn't. Yeah. And to be clear, that SNL sketch, the song about rape culture or whatever, it wasn't that it was about rape. I'm with you. I don't think any subject is off limits. It's that it was this heavy-handed preaching, moralizing thing, and it wasn't actually funny.
It's like, who is this
Like,
for? I think that's what a
yeah.
lot of it is. It's like, we can, most people can laugh at anything if it's delivered in a way that's like surprising or clever or interesting, and we can receive it. And like your friend was saying, oh, it's so important. It's not important if it turns people off, and stuff that's heavy-handed and on the nose usually does. So you're not, the people who need to hear it aren't going to hear it anyway.
Yeah, exactly. You're just it, you might as well be a church at that point.
Yeah, this one feels like, oh my gosh. So I was at, I
What?
was at an event once. It was I was I don't know. Is your show like family friendly?
Well, yeah. There's all, but if there's something like, why is it a dirty word or something?
I was at an event that was for adults. Okay. I was curious. It was a thing, and they were basically,
we talk about anything here.
My friend had invited me once, and I'm very much like, I'll do any, like I'll try anything. So he invited me to a dungeon once, and I didn't realize that.
Oh yeah,
okay. It was very, very woke. And so there's like a 30 minute like lecture beforehand, and that one was about like body neutrality in the BDSM community, and it would be hilarious if this was a sketch. Like, honestly, I kind of was inspired to like maybe come up with something later, because everybody there was so deadly serious about it. They're like, you know, body neutrality, blah, 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 which, yeah, like, you know, I'm for that. I'm like, your body is your body. Like, you know, you hate it, love it. Like, you know, have feelings about it, but it's your body. So, you know, you got to live in it. But the way that she was like, okay, people in the audience were raising their hands, and they were like, what about differently abled queer, like they were labeling off, you know, all of their, you know, badges of honor or whatever, and she's like, well, so this applies to that, because, and like seeing her do these mental gymnastics was so entertaining. And one of the people was like, how does body neutrality apply to differently abled Americans, or like whatever the current phrase is. And she's like, well, for example, I was, she's like, I'm a, you know, 6 foot tall, 250 pound woman. So when I straddle a man, he's, his legs might go numb. But one time I was with a quadriplegic and he didn't feel it. So in that situation, being differently abled was a plus. And I'm sitting here like, this lady is like not, like, I'm laughing. I'm dying laughing. Cause to me, that's funny, but she's like saying it completely earnestly, and everybody's
totally,
like,
seriously,
so important.
We have a similar sense of humor, I think, because that also would be like setting off bells in my head. Like, this is, I feel like I'm in a sketch,
right? Like a prank show. Like, you're wondering if they have a camera somewhere. Like, are, like, what's going on? Nobody else gets it.
Oh my goodness, that's hilarious. Okay, you have to do one about that now that you've told us the story behind it. We'll all know that it was inspired by true events.
By true, yes. Or based on a true story. It's like, it'll be an Oscar contender.
So I've got another one just to show people your range. I've got another one I want to put up. I think this was the first one I saw of yours, which I just died. This is back when the establishment was attacking gas stoves.
Oh, yeah.
You know what's funny, while that was happening, my husband and I were renovating this old house of ours, and we were shopping, I was shopping for gas stoves online. I hadn't bought one yet, but at that time, back when this whole thing was going on, you'll find that I didn't have an ad blocker. I'm kind of technologically challenged in some ways. And so every time I was doing my podcast, there'd be these throbbing stove ads like moving around. Everybody's like, turn off the stoves.
People always make fun of me during my live streams with Mike because of that. Like, I'll be showing them something. They're like, why do you have ads? And I was like, I don't know.
Well, hey, someone told me get ad blocker. It works. So do it if you haven't done it yet.
Is it okay, just like an app plugin?
Yeah, it's a plugin. Okay. It's great. Even I could do it. Okay, guys, this is Mothers Against Gas Assault Stoves.
You found the weapons of mass destruction. They're in your kitchen. Every year, millions of Americans are harmed by gas stoves. A gas stove attacked my kid, melted her face clean off. You want to see?
I lost my husband to a gas stove. They're probably on a beach in Boca Raton together right now.
A gas stove killed my Travis.
Mom, when's dinner gonna be?
We are Mothers Against Gas Assault Stove.
Okay, I'm stopping there.
They got to see the demise of Travis.
Travis.
It's what matters. We have to remember. Never forget.
There's so many things funny about that. It's not just, it's your delivery, it's ma Travis, it's the name choice. Travis is great. Like, there's just so many little choices there that make that mwah.
I appreciate that, and a lot of people enjoy, people who know guns enjoy that the shotgun was a fully automatic shotgun that's just like Like, listen, I didn't have a fully automatic weapon laying around. My machine gun's in the shop. Sorry.
It's just so silly. Oh man, I'm so glad I get to talk to you. This is good, probably the most laughs in an interview yet.
Oh, I'm glad.
So,
and sorry, I feel like I'm like, I get excited about an idea and then I take us off on a tangent. So feel free to like,
oh, that's okay.
Water bottle and pull me back in.
Okay, I just wanted to show a couple, just to show people how funny you are. So, well, let's talk about your story though. So, you, when did you get into the world of like acting? All the stuff that you do, writing, comedy writing, all of that.
I feel like I was always a little performer. Like even when I was a kid, I would perform for my parents, and then I was so shy. I was so like deathly shy, and I'd be like, "Turn around and don't look at me," while I would perform. And they're like, "How are you going to be a performer if nobody sees you?" Eventually, I got over that. I started doing theater, which, to be fair, theater. I recently did something where I didn't have the lights off, and it is still just as intimidating. Theater, they're in the dark. So you kind of are still like having a bit of separation between you and the audience. So I think that's kind of a way around people just seeing you. So I did theater in, I started thinking like middle school, and we did this show where they were basically being cheap and didn't want to have to pay for the rights to do like a real show. So they had the students write our own play called Channel Surfing. And so it was a bunch of sketches and they were like changing the channel and we were playing what you saw on the TV. So it gave me a chance to start writing like my first sketches. Okay. And so it was kind of cool. Like it was, and it, you know, it was like eighth grade humor, but it was funny at the time. So like in one of them, I played like the crocodile hunter and he's like harassing all the animals at, you know, at the mall at PetSmart. And he gets like dragged out. I had one where it was like Martha Stewart teaching you how to make a Mother's Day picture frame out of like macaroni and like fingernail clippings. Like it was like so like middle school humor, but like at the time it was kind of what changed my life in a way, because it helped me get out of my shell, because I always thought I was weird and I was always hiding that.
Yeah.
Doing theater and doing my own writing and showing the world my sense of humor, suddenly, like, I didn't really have friends that whole year because I moved around a lot. So we had just moved, it was eighth grade, so moving near the end of middle school, everybody's already friends with each other. They don't really want anything to do with you. After that, suddenly everybody's like, you're the funny girl. Like, you're the girl who did this and that. You're the crocodile hunter girl. So I kind of realized like, oh, weird isn't always a bad thing. Like weird can be, make people want to be around you because they feel comfortable with you, because they feel like they can be weird too, or, you know, they find you funny or whatever. So after that, I couldn't get enough of it. So I did theater in high school. I was a theater major in college. And then I got into voiceover because, again, the whole like, I can be whatever I want. Nobody has to see me. Mm-hmm. I went to LA, which it's weird. I needed LA for where I am in my career, but also it was deeply traumatizing for me, I feel like, because of some of the stuff we talked about. I was there for about 8 years, and then eventually I moved to Atlanta because I couldn't take LA anymore.
Tell me a little more about that, because I know I was there for 15 years and I often refer to it as I did my time there.
I did time
in California.
What is it? What is the life? I mean, isn't one life sentence 20 years or 25 years? So you almost did a life sentence.
Yes, almost. And I have my own experience with certain things about LA and why I'm glad I don't live there anymore. But tell me about that, what that was like.
Yeah, it was fun in my early 20s because it was like exciting and it was that city of opportunity where everybody there is trying to hustle. But after a while, it kind of starts to grate on you because, first of all, I don't think anybody should always be surrounded by people in the same industry as you. I think we need friends who are, you know, farmers or accountants. Like, you need people to keep you grounded. You need people to remind you what real people are like.
Yes. It's all, you're so right. Living in a tiny country town now in the South, you know, I'm like, this is back to my roots in a way. But I'm reminded of that. I think of it as my old life back there. And you're right. It's so isolated. Everybody's in the industry in one way or another. And by the way, that used to creep me out anyway, that it was called the industry. Like, it's not the steel industry or everybody just says the industry. If you don't know this, have never lived in LA, everyone says the industry and they mean entertainment. But it's funny because I always like to play dumb. Like, if you're in a conversation, like, you know, well, he's in the industry, and I'm like, steel,
right? Like, He cobbles shoes. What is this?
So it's a lot of the same kind of person. I didn't mean to too much.
No, it's all good. It's the same kind of person. It's a lot of like, I mean, I would have Uber drivers hand me their demo reel if I said, like, oh, I'm with this agent or whatever. Like, you kind of can't escape it. So it's kind of unhealthy in that way, where you feel this sense of there's like a scarcity mentality in the air. And this might get a little woo-woo, but you can feel like different cities have different energies. Like some cities have kind of like depressing energies. And LA to me has this energy of like hunger, but not always in a good way. Like it feels like it's just kind of like people are like, do you see me? Do you love me? Do you see me? Do you love me? How can you help me? Like, and they're always looking over your shoulder to see like if there's somebody more famous or higher up than you who could get them what they need. Like, and obviously there's some good people in every city. I made some really great friends there. So that's not saying everybody there's like that, but it's, you always have to wonder like, what do you want in LA? Whereas here, a lot of my friends are like, oh, you're an actor? That's so cool. Like, tell me about that. But they're like, I have no desire to do that. So it's not like they're using me for my contacts or whatever, if that makes sense.
Yes, it makes total sense. You're right. Everyone there is, one of my friends, Jared Bauer, he's been on the channel before. Mm-hmm. He was the founder of Wisecrack, which is a very popular YouTube comedy channel, comedy and academic channel. And he eventually sold it. His whole employee, in the interview, he talks about this, so I'll just say it. Like a lot of the people he hired, his whole company ended up becoming woke, his own company, and it was kind of suffocating for him. Anyway, he got out, sold the company, left the country, and we did an interview, and he described LA as one of the words you just used, like desperation. Like you could smell it on people. There's just this, it's not a healthy hunger, like the way you put it.
No.
I don't know. I don't know what I haven't been back in a while, but I imagine it's still pretty similar.
I was there recently for like 2 days for like a premiere. And it was the first time I had been back since before COVID. I think COVID broke that city. I think maybe in a good way, because there's a lot of people there who became more, I don't know, I hate labels, but I guess, I don't know if it's red pilled or more like they kind of started realizing like, wait a second, I lost my job. You know, like, so I have noticed that there is a lot more tension in LA. Like it used to be much more like we all think the same. And there might have always been people there who were rebellious or thought differently and they just didn't say anything. And maybe COVID made them more bold. And so they found each other or something. But you can definitely sense there's a little bit more of a fraction.
Like an actual resistance.
Yeah. Like, and so I'm interested in that. I mean, I don't think it's going to be big enough to ever change the industry completely, but I definitely think like, It's different because before when I was in LA, you didn't realize it wasn't the real world because it was like everybody watches the same news. Your social media is always filtering stuff so that you're only seeing what you already believe. So you're not really seeing different opinions there. So you start to think that your opinions and the opinions of everybody around you, because everybody there votes the same and whatever, mm-hmm. you start to think that that's mainstream. So it's not until like I started like looking at other places to go, because thankfully I grew up in other places. I was an Air Force kid. I grew up in a lot of different places. So I'm like, okay. I always had a little bit of a foot in reality, being like, I don't think this is reality. But LA makes you think, oh, well, maybe this is what people are supposed to think. This is the enlightened West Coast elite.
Yes.
And these are the ideas you should have. And those ideas are quaint, but they're not what you should think.
And we're better.
And it's weird because they're some of the most empathetic people, but some of them are very like bleeding heart. And that's where I get the whole bleeding heart edge lady thing from, where some of them really care. And a lot of their ideas are misguided, mm-hmm. but come from a place of, I really want to care. I really want to help, you know,
good
whatever
intentions.
Good intentions.
Yeah.
But completely uneducated on the actual reality of situations or what would actually be helpful. And then you just have a lot of people who are in it about control or wanting to feel like the pious, like I'm the most righteous of all of you. So you have different kinds of people there,
yes.
but it's a lot of the SJW's anonymous sketch is pretty much kind of summing up a lot of my experiences there, where everybody's a little bit afraid to be like, I swiped right on a conservative on Tinder. Oh my God. Like, there's not really a lot of grace, I feel like. So it's a lot of the most empathetic people and a lot of the most judgmental people I've ever met, which is weird for artists. You'd think artists would be the weird ones who are open to the most ideas, like to pushing boundaries. But I'm finding I found LA had a lot of conformity in the thinking aspect. And that was really weird to me.
Yes. Let me ask you about this, because I think what's happened is we're living in the upside down right now. I think historically, humans, we go through these cycles. We're in one of those cycles right now where sociopathy, like sociopaths, narcissists, like all that stuff rules the ideology and people who are like that. And up is down, down is up. Everything's kind of inverted. And so I think what's happened is that artists, people who typically have this openness about them, are made to stifle that openness or because of social conditioning and to believe that they're still very open while being pushed and, or pulled into this very judgmental belief system, puritanical belief system. And so my question for you is, if you think that's what's been happening too, like, do you see that breaking soon?
I do a little bit, but maybe that's just me being optimistic. But I'm finding, even on Twitter, I mean, I'm not really on Twitter a ton. I'm really bad with social media. I'll do bursts of it and then I'll like not be on it for months. But because it gets in my head. So Twitter and social media are the most extreme of all sides anyway. But I'm finding even the people who are the crazy left like a year or two ago who were like, cancel them, cancel this and that. You know, you can't say that. How dare you? Let's strip you of your job. I'm finding more people from even the left speaking up, being like, hey, can we cool it?
Yes. So
I'm thinking that's a good sign. And I'm also seeing people starting to push back a little bit in Hollywood. Again, it's like the big corporations, I don't know why they're not listening, because to them, you think it's just about money. They're not in it for art. And they've been losing money because of all these dumb, stale ideas they're putting out there. So you would think that eventually they'd try, like, you know, like, all right, let's go back and see like what an original or edgy or pushing the boundaries idea could do. But I don't know why they're stuck. But at least on a smaller grassroots level, I'm starting to notice artists being a little bit fed up with, oh, we can't say this, we can't do that. I'm starting to see, like, I've shared some of my sketches with like some people in my industry that I thought would never be cool with it. Like, I've been like, hey, like, what do you think about this? And they're like, oh, this is really good satire. And I like that it makes fun of both sides. Or like, oh, okay, like, I could see, even if I might not agree with your politics or whatever, I appreciate like the comedy in this. Like, this is still funny. So there's nuance. I think it's one-on-one though. I don't know. I think Hollywood, a lot of people, I guess that makes sense. We're all kind of, and I'm not speaking for managers, because that's what you were, right? You were a comedy manager.
Yeah, I was a manager and producer, yeah.
I at least know for actors, a lot of us are kind of damaged in some way where we want approval. Like, maybe we didn't get it from our parents or whatever.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah.
Everybody in Hollywood, like, I had a joke. I did stand up like once or twice, but in my set, I had a joke where it's like everybody in LA was like all the people who were like running from their problems and their dysfunction, their bad. You just hit the West Coast and they like were like, well, I like they ran into the water. And they're like, oh, okay, I guess I'll stay here and get a couple co-star credits before I walk into the sea. Like, it's a lot of people who I think deeply need to belong. I mean, everybody needs to belong, it's on the hierarchy of needs, you know, but like actors, very much we are pack people. We're like, what is everybody else doing, what is everybody else thinking? Or we shouldn't be, but that's kind of what I think we are. And I think it's because actors have the least power, because we're not the ones creating the projects, we're not the ones funding them, so we kind of have to appease the powers that be. So if you have an actor who's saying things that might get your business in trouble, they're not going to hire you. So you kind of have to be like, I hate the word like sheep, you got to be a sheeple, but you got to kind of toe the line, be neutral, be malleable, be whatever they want you to be, just smile and show up where they want you to go. But that's not, you know, the real artists, or the George Carlins or the Richard Pryors or Marlon Brando's or whatever. Like, those were people who like did their own thing. People weren't always happy about it, but they were willing to be themselves. And I don't think we have a lot of those right now. And then
they are the mother of invention. And because they break the rules, they take the risk. Not everyone's happy, but they create something new. They're doing something, you know, genius. And then what happens? People imitate them. And then people become so accustomed to that, whatever that trend is, and that kind of comedy or that kind of entertainment. And then it takes someone to take a risk and do something else that's different before. And sometimes doing what's different is, as I'm hearing you talk about people getting tired of this and entertainment studios maybe needing to come up with something that's actually new, actually edgy. Sometimes what's new and edgy is what's old. Yeah. Like sometimes it goes in cycles, right?
Yeah. So, like a Blazing Saddles or something, like something that's, you know, yes. Traffic Thunder, like going backwards to like what we used to laugh at and yes. trying that.
Yes. Well, I'm happy to hear you say, even though you say it's maybe you're just being optimistic, maybe me too, but that's also my sense is one-on-one. I know people who a year ago were telling me they didn't get me or they thought I'd become alt-right or something crazy who are now saying, okay, I get it. But we're not all like that. And they're less like they're trying to distance them. They still want to be on the, they're too afraid to have their identities wrapped up in being part of this group, right? They're too afraid to sever that tie in that way. But it's almost like I'm noticing from people one-on-one, they're wanting to put distance between themselves and what they view as the more extreme, unfunny mm-hmm. part of their side, of the woke.
The more, like my friend Timmy says that, like, it used to be like the, when we were younger, it felt like it was like the religious right, like the, and again, I hate, like, it's not all religious people. It's not all conservatives. But when I was a kid, it was the ones who were like, you can't watch The Simpsons. It's satanic.
Yes.
You can't watch that. It's satanic. Like, you
Smurfs.
Know, yeah. Everything was the devil. Harry Potter, like they were like, burn Harry Potter. And now they're like, burn Harry Potter. And it's like the same church ladies in their like little Argyle sweaters, but like they're like rainbow sweaters now. That's the only difference. Like it's the same. And I think it's because maybe, I don't think those people would be their parents. Would they, like the ones who were, when we were kids, would those be this generation's parents or would that be the next generation's?
It could be a little bit of, it could be some of their parents because you and I grew up, you're a little younger than me, but I grew up, my parents' generation was the one that was part of that. That was a part of the religious right. That was a part of the Jerry Falwell stuff. And, you know, the Smurfs are Satanists. And
Satan. And now everything is coded for racism. Like the church lady from SNL where it's like, could it be Satan? Now it's just, could it be racism?
Exactly. That's so funny because that's one of... You should be in this with me. I'm just going to say this to you on air right now. We've talked about doing an updated church lady from an SNL, but it's an SJW church lady. Would you please do that with me?
I absolutely would. I'm all for anything that's funny.
Okay. Sometime. Or if not that, we'll come up with another idea because I would love to just have laughs with you. Oh my God.
No, that'd be fun.
You notice how I did this on air, so now you have to do it.
Now it's like a verbal contract.
Damn it.
No,
I tricked me.
I've been trying to find creative people to collaborate with. Like the reason I tend to play all of my characters in my own sketches is because none of my actor friends want to risk their careers, which I totally get. Like it's why I'm still kind of hesitant. Like I could share it on my like actor social media, but like I represent somebody else's brand and I'm like, I don't know, like as a So, like, I want to one day be able to merge my worlds. But for now, like, I'd love to find, like, I keep trying to get, maybe if I say this on air, maybe people will pressure him. But I keep trying to get Clifton because Clifton Duncan lives in Atlanta. And I was like, Clifton, be in my stuff. He's like, okay. But then, like, when I reach out for certain things, he'll be like.
Clifton, be in a comedy sketch. Man of the sultry voice. Yes.
Right? Like, there's a lot of people out there that I would love to collaborate with. I just need to, I'm like the Nick Fury. Well, I guess Nick Fury actually assembles people, but I want to assemble like my Avengers of like problematic comedy people.
Oh, I love it. I'm here for whatever you do. can we take a break and just watch one more clip? Okay.
Yes.
Okay, guys.
You're asking an actor if people will like stop and watch their stuff. I'm like, please watch my stuff all day. I need attention.
This one is, did you accidentally stumble on, I can't even read it. Did you read it?
You accidentally stumble onto Epstein's Island? Don't panic. Help is on the way.
Help! I went to Jeffrey Epstein's magical underage sex island, and now I might spend the rest of my life in prison.
Well, you came to the right place. At Epstein Oopstein Cleanup Services, we'll ensure you'll still get your happy ending. And not just the one given to you by a teenager in the Virgin Islands. Got someone who knows too much about your minor mishaps? With our basic package, we'll ensure that any potential snitches will indeed get stitches. And if you purchase our platinum package, if your name does get leaked to the press, we'll distract the media with your choice of war, a new variant, balloons, other balloons, and slaps.
So all you do is just hang a guy in prison and then lose the footage of it?
Listen, guy, I'm the professional here. I don't go to your job and tell you how to diddle kids and ruin the country, okay?
Yep, no, that's fair.
Thank you.
If you're a dirty politician, celebrity, or other elite, then Epstein Oopstein can't be beat.
Yeah, that's catchy. If you like underage girls in your bed, we promise we won't turn you into the Fed.
Yeah, all right. I know you're not. My name was on the client list, the flight log.
Okay, I'm stopping. I feel like I still have to leave a little bit of going
so they'll come
the
speak it out.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. So good.
No, I appreciate that. Like, that's funny that Epstein was one of the first ones I wrote, but one of the latest ones I put out, because my brain kept being like, I don't know if this is going to keep being relevant, or like my Tucker Carlson and Green M&M's one. Like, it's funny how like the media keeps cycling things back where every couple months it becomes relevant again. So my sketches never fully die. I can like always redo them.
I think Epstein is always going to be relevant, kind of like the Kennedy assassination. It's just one of those things that's never going to be, we're never going to know the truth. And, you know, I sometimes get upset that, like, I want to do next time. I've jokingly said the next protest that happens in Austin, whatever the protest is, you know, it'll be some woke crap. I want to go with a sign that's just like, tell us what happened to Kennedy. Like, it's been long enough. Why are there not people in the streets with those signs? You know,
right.
Like, if you're going to protest something, it's like, do you think the American people deserve to know by now? Like, and I hope that people are still asking that question about Epstein decades from now, because you know they're not going to.
I keep hearing each week, they're like, they're going to release the list. I'm like, no, they're not. Mm-hmm. Like, people will die before that list is released. Like, nothing's going to happen.
Yeah. I don't think. And we don't, they rely on us not caring enough to make a stink about it. Like, we only, as a population, I say we, not you and me, but we get in the streets for stuff they manipulate us to get in the streets for.
Mm-hmm.
And the stuff they don't want us in the streets for, well, we're not there. So
that's, I mean, to be fair, I think I'm probably lazy enough that I probably wouldn't get in the streets for anything. Cause I'm like, I don't like the heat. I don't like standing. And even when I was like, I don't know if I ever was on the left, I was a Democrat, but I was like, I never wore a pussy hat or whatever they call it, the pink ones.
Yeah.
I never like marched anywhere. I was just kind of like from my couch, like, yeah, girl power. I like this place, girls and stuff. Yeah, all right. I guess Hillary's pantsuits are cool. Okay.
Well,
so like,
well,
I was never a full SJW or social justice warrior. I was in the social justice reserves, I say.
You were in the reserves? Oh, girl, I was in combat. I was in social justice combat, the front lines in the foxholes, in the, you know, not really. But that's why I was out there with my signs. I was always protesting handmade signs. I was in a running club, a social justice running club. That's how much I hate it. You know, it was called Run Against Bush. And we literally just got together to go jogging in activist t-shirts. Like, that's how
it, because that's how you change the world.
Yeah. It bled into everything I did. But I want to ask you about something. So you said you were in the social justice reserves from
I never, I was never called to duty. I was like, oh, here, you need me, I guess. I'm probably not super fit to battle. I don't really know what we're fighting about. I'm just told. I read a Jezebel or BuzzFeed article about it once.
Well, so that encourages me, because I think a lot of people who are just kind of tangential, like woke adjacent, who are just sort of in it because that's the environment that you're in. And you're like a fish in water and you're part of your environment, but you're not this rabid, you know, true believer or activist. I think a lot of those people have the potential to like recognize what's wrong with it.
Mm-hmm.
If we make the case culturally, like you and I are talking about, I think some people are starting to recognize what's wrong with it. So just tell me a little bit about, you said you're politically homeless. Have you ever at any point been a very actively political in any party, or how do you, I hate the word, but identify, or you're not a part of any party? Or
I mean, technically, I guess I would say, because I probably hang out the most with like libertarians right now. But like, I think my thing when I say politically homeless is whenever you try to claim like an identity, you always have the gatekeepers who tell you you're not enough of whatever that thing is. Yes. So for me, I'm like, why bother? Like growing up mixed race, you know, as a kid, people are like, are you black? Or are you white? You're like, oh, I guess I'm this. They're like, no, you're not. You're not enough of that. You're like, oh, I guess I'm the other thing. They're like, oh, you're too good to be one of us. Like it was just constantly somebody else was always fighting for what your identity was. So I was like, okay, well, I don't care. I'm mixed then. And then, you know, and so I've always kind of been comfortable in the Daywalker category. That's why I call my channel Daywalker, because I've always kind of moved between worlds. Like my mom's from France. My dad's from America. I had like a weird international upbringing. My dad was a Black Republican. So he was also kind of like a weird anomaly in his thing. So I kind of got to see different perspectives and different experiences. And I kind of sat like on the, not on the fence, because I have strong opinions about things, but if somebody presents me with good information, I'm willing to change my view. And so my problem with like parties is that I feel like a lot of times the allegiance to it is more important than like truth, or more important than what's helpful. So like there are times where I'm like, okay, yes, in theory, this would be good. But in reality, what do we actually do? You know? So I don't know, like a lot of my friends who are like trying to ban, therefore banning guns or whatever, I understand that in their hearts, they think if we ban guns, nobody gets hurt. But unfortunately, we don't live in that world. So like, I'm not, you know, like they think that everybody who's pro 2A is like, you know, I love people getting hurt with guns. It's like, no, it's, I want to be able to defend myself as a, you know, as a woman pulling the woke card, I guess. But like, as a woman, I'm never going to be able to take down a dude who's bigger than me if he's coming at me, if he's trying to attack me. The gun is the only chance I have to defend myself. There was a woman in my neighborhood that got kidnapped and killed because a bigger guy like grabbed her and took her into his car. So I feel like when you are able to sit outside of the party's idea, you can look at ideas as opposed to like, I feel like a lot of people in parties are like, I'm this because I vote all the way down the line. And I think that's weird. Like to me, I feel like it should be a la carte. It should be like, okay, on this issue, I feel this way. And they say most Americans are like that. Most Americans kind of are a little bit over here on this, a little bit over here on this. They're flexible on this issue. Like most of us are not these hard and fast extremes, like these black and white things that you see on social media. Those are the loudest people. Those are the people who are more likely to engage in internet combat. So they're probably already going to have a certain personality type, but most people are moderate or independent or have some issues on either side that they identify with. So that's kind of what I mean when I say politically homeless. I definitely identify with a lot of liberty values, a lot of individualism, you know, I'm like pro-capitalism, all that stuff. But I don't like it when it's like, well, yeah, we all think this way, right? Because I'm like, what happened to being a free thinker? Like, I'm going to take every issue and develop my own thoughts on it.
This resonates so much with me. Yeah, thank you. Because when I left, so I was a lifelong Democrat, you know, and not just a Democrat, but I was pulled into you and thoroughly embraced social justice, wokeness, which is not liberalism. It took me a long time to figure that out, but it was such a part of my identity. Mm-hmm. And when I had my long waking up process, which was very long, and leaving it, I never ended up joining another political party. Mm-hmm. I briefly switched to the Green Party for less than a year. I don't know, for one election I had switched to Green. And then I just, when I moved to Texas, I'm an independent and I don't plan on, and that bothers some people. It's very much like, well, why are you afraid of being a, just say you're a conservative, be a Republican? But because I don't feel like, you articulated it very well. I don't feel like I am exactly right now. Right. I'm voting. I find myself voting Republican a lot in the past election anyway, but I kind of don't want to get into that same place I was in where everything is just dictated. You're so easy to control when you're a tribalist, because all they have to do, the powers that be, the media, the politicians, all they have to do is say this party's for this, this party's for that. And a great example is the COVID regulations. Because at the beginning, most of the people I knew at the very beginning, before they got their messaging straight on what was the right and what was the left.
For their sides, like their marching orders.
Yeah. Before that happened, most of the people I knew who were protesting, who were against the COVID regulations, were on the left, which makes sense. They're anti-big pharma, they're anti-authoritarianism.
Right? Anti-government, anti-authority.
Right? And then they came in and said, it was basically like, you know, all the media, everything's like, oh, these right-wing people protesting the COVID regulation. And so then people just kind of line up with their side without thinking. I'm like, are you kidding me? But I saw some people who never did. Like, there were still in Georgetown, Texas, there was a group every weekend protesting the mask mandates, and they were mostly leftist hippies. And that gave me encouragement. I was like, those guys know what they believe, and they're not easily manipulated by what their tribe says, you know?
I think that's the cool thing is that, like, I feel like a lot of times it seems like the parties will switch or whatever. And like you said, it's like their values change based on what the party says. And I think that's why parties are dangerous. I understand it helps people like strengthen numbers, but I really wish people would go look at individual issues instead of being like, well, what am I supposed to think? What is like, you know, when it comes to, I don't know, people say, oh, black people should always vote Democrat. Like the Republicans don't care about you. And like, look, I don't think any establishment politician cares about you. But if we look at school choice or something like that, I think it was like 70% of black parents want school choice for their kids. They want to be able to say, hey, the school in my neighborhood, that's the public school in my district is crappy and in a bad neighborhood. It's dangerous. I want to be able to send them to a charter school. I want to be able to send them to a place where they have a chance.
Yeah.
Technically, that's a conservative policy point. Now, not all conservatives are, you know, pro school choice, but it's just interesting that like when I describe that to my Democrat friends and I don't label whose idea that is, they're like, oh yeah, that sounds really good.
They love it. They love it until you tell them, oh, the media says that's a right wing position. Then they're like, oh no, it's a right wing position.
Just backtrack.
Yeah.
Well, what about the public schools? And what about the, you know, it's just like, it's just so interesting to see how people, you know, and that's why it's been really painful for me to watch artists. And, you know, like my boyfriend's into like punk rock music and he has a hard time. He's trying to find people to play with, you know, but like everybody is like painfully like, if you like guns or if you like this or that, like don't play with us. And so he's just like, I'm just trying to find reasonable people who are just punk rock and who are like, you know, screw the government and screw you is kind of his
quote. Can I tell you another quick, I know people watch Deprogrammed regularly have already heard this, but I'll make it really quick because I don't know, you probably haven't heard this, Amanda. Somebody in our Deprogrammed community sent me a screenshot who's punk. And it was some interaction online where they were arguing with someone who calls himself punk. And the punk person they were arguing with basically said, well, because they were like, isn't punk supposed to be anti-corporation, anti-big pharma, and anti-war, and anti-government? And this punk person was like, well, yeah, but that was back when, see, now the government and the corporations are on our side. They're on the right side of history. Yeah. So now we're, now punk is like for those things. It's like, what?
Like, no government is ever going to be like, yay, we're for the people. They're for themselves. There are people in the government who I think want to maybe do good things, but the government as a whole, it's just weird when people simp for politicians. I'm like, why don't you like go and do good in your community? You know, volunteer at your church or your local charities, like make a difference on your level, because you should not be waiting for people up there to do anything. Like, they're going to sit and just debate and waste your dollars.
They do not care. I agree. They don't care. Do you have a fear now being blacklisted?
It's weird, because if I was very afraid of it, I don't think I would ever put anything out there, or at least not with my face on it. So there's part of me that I think there's a part of me that's a weird like piece that I know in like maybe 5 years, maybe 10 years, we'll be back to the pendulum always swings. So I feel like whatever we're in will not last. There might be a chance that I could be blacklisted now, like maybe for the next year or two. But I think as this movement's petering out, and I think Chappelle, honestly, like I think that's why I started my channel kind of finally after debating it and writing all these sketches. I finally started it after Netflix stood by Dave Chappelle with his Closer controversy, because it made me realize, like, I think they're realizing, like, most people don't care. They just want to laugh. Like, most people.
Yeah.
Are not like these sensitive, you know, scolds and Puritans. And that gave me hope that like even Hollywood is going to make the right decision and just be like, all right.
It's a sign of your optimism and your belief in, I think, truth and goodness that, yeah, you're like, oh, I'll put my face on this. I'm not looking to give them the gun to shoot me with, but
right. I'm not going to like retweet it to like my, I don't know, it was like 9,000 or 10,000 or whatever on my actor page, because you know, a lot of people in the, especially like anime fandom, are a lot more like, kind of, I don't want to say on the left, but they are a lot more on TikTok. They're young, they don't fully understand the nuances of things, so to them it's good versus evil. So they think, yeah, if you don't agree with everything that they believe, oh my gosh, you must hate me, you must want me dead. It's like, no, there's so many shades in between. Like, I'm very much like, I love most people. That's why I'm a bleeding heart edge lady. Like, I like making the jokes, but I care about people, and I don't ever try to make jokes at a person's expense, except maybe Epstein, but he's dead, so who cares? Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I really think that there's a place for that, where it doesn't have to be mean. Comedy doesn't have to be mean spirited. It can be a joke. Yeah. And I'm not trying to say I want you to not exist anymore. I've got this thing. I always joke it's my gay hell mouth. Like, it looks like it's just like they just like rave back there, and they just like come like my I can summon my gaze whenever I want.
What is the poster behind you? Because it looks very 80s, 90s inspired.
With a poster
with the phone and
this is all like my 90s wall. Here, I'll try to
show, okay,
like a Princess Diana.
You have got to meet. You've got to come hang out with us one Wednesday night for our live show, me and Mystery Chris. He loves 80s, 90s art. He's an amazing artist.
That'd be awesome.
Designed, yeah, some of our backgrounds and stuff, like the really 90s one. Anyway, you got to meet him because you have a similar aesthetic there going on.
I love that. The 90s, like, well, because also it just made me feel like when I was designing my room, like I had my green screen over there and I'm like, this is my playroom. This is reminds me of my childhood, like when I was the most creative and free and I wasn't as afraid. I mean, I was anxious, but I wasn't as afraid of these rules of what you can and can't create and all that. So I feel like it inspired me to be like, oh yeah, I just played.
Gosh, did you have the sticker? What was her name? Lisa?
Lisa Frank?
Lisa Frank stuff.
Yeah.
You have all that stuff? Yeah.
Yeah. Lisa Frank. And you had like those like slappy bracelets. I had Tamagotchis. I was that kid.
I still got some of those slap bracelets. That's funny. Okay. I want to talk to you again.
Yeah.
This has been fun. It feels super short, actually. This went so fast. But I want to have you back if you'll come back.
Yeah.
Do a live show with us. Hang out. I could talk to you forever. And I'm a big fan of your work, what you're doing. I think you're amazing. I think your heart is obvious. You didn't even have to tell me you don't need to be mean in your comedy. It's obvious. There's like joy in your comedy. So keep doing what you're doing. Tell people, you guys can find links below, but tell people, for anyone who's listening, where they can find you online if they want to laugh.
Yeah. So find me at Daywalker Comedy on all the social medias, but mainly YouTube. That's where we have Epic Mike and I have our weekly live stream. We kind of paused it right now because there's some health issues and stuff going on. Oh, the camera's getting all fuzzy. It's my ghost. I have a ghost in my house. That's a fun
thing. Mine messes with the lights.
Oh, fun. Yours like they kind of flicker.
Yeah.
Oh, we can compare ghost stories next time. That'll be the Halloween special.
Yes.
But yeah, find me on YouTube. I'm also on Rumble, Odyssey, Twitter, Instagram. I'm not as active on those as I should be, but find me on all of them and I'll promise one day I will be. But YouTube's the main one.
You guys go subscribe. Tell her you found her from Deprogrammed. Thank you so much, Amanda, Daywalker Comedy, for being with us.